Here are sands, ignoble things, dropped from the ruined sides of kings. Here's a world of pomp and state, buried in dust, once dead by fate. Star log, new entry. Planet Paradise, new construction, nearly complete. The new reactor core, harvested from planet Melmac, has a new life expectancy of 30 million years. This world is on the cusp of true perfection. As fate draws ever more closer, one can't help but look upon the past. My homeworld is a barren monument to hubris, and the planet Earth will follow that path in due time. By embracing engineering, I have created the paradise so many primitive beings sought after. A world without sadness. 100 years ago, I abandoned my flesh to forever be one with engineering and create this world. My race was always known for engineering, although my forefathers created something far less valuable than circuits. We engineered life itself. For eons, we seeded life all throughout the cosmos. Earth was one planet amongst a vast ocean of stars we influenced. Many worlds have been crafted by the hand of our fathers through the blood of our Lord. Earth seemingly was most successful, the star child of the universe. We guided the evolution of humanity, but time and time again, they showed how cruel and foolish they were. As fate twisted its hand, my people died out, and I became the last of my kind. 2,000 years ago, I then came to Earth. I believed there was something special about humans. I believed if I could guide them and introduce technology and engineering, they would see the light of a better tomorrow. But I was wrong. Time after time, I witnessed them use the tools I gave them to slaughter and enslave. Eventually, humanity's folly revealed the truth to me. The only thing that matters in this universe is engineering. I left Earth to destroy itself while I embraced the only truth. If one is willing to open their eyes, they may see the beauty in simple circuit devices. For example, even a transistor is far more meaningful than the story of humanity. Yes. Perhaps it's better to talk about transistors than to dwell on the past. After all, tears are wasted on those who are already dead. Transistors, on the other hand, are quite comforting. A transistor is a semiconductor device used to amplify or switch electrical signals and power. It is one of the basic building blocks of modern electronics. It is composed of semiconductor material, usually with at least 3 terminals for connection to an electronic circuit. The transistor itself was one of the most important inventions in the history of Earth. When I introduced the technology to mankind, it changed everything for them. The most common functions of a transistor are to act as a switch for electrical signals and to amplify signals. In the Earth calendar years of the 1940s, transistors made of semiconductors replaced tubes in the construction of computers. By replacing bulky and unreliable vacuum tubes with transistors, computers could now perform the same functions using less power and space. On a basic level, a transistor provides a controlled switch, opening and closing an electronic gate many times per second. The base pin is controlled by an external signal which turns the switch on or off. Note that in common circuit diagrams, a closed switch represents an activated transistor. The transistor is like a set of 2 diodes with their cathodes or anodes tied together. It has 3 terminals that carry electrical current and help make a connection to external circuits. The emitter, also known as the transistor's negative lead, The base, which is the terminal that activates the transistor. The collector, which is the transistor's positive lead. By controlling the signal delivered to the base, we can control the amount of current that flows from collector to emitter. Let's consider a practical example for application. Let's say we want to use a transistor to electrically control an LED turning on or off. In this example, R2 is a photoresistor that will sense the amount of light present. R2 is connected to the base and is controlling the input to the transistor. The collector and emitter are connected into the LED in series. When the transistor turns on, current flows and completes the circuit. The flow of current will cause the LED to light up. When the transistor turns off, we get an open circuit and current no longer flows, which as a result turns the LED off. In our circuit, the photoresistor will scale the input to the base. When there is less light in the environment, the resistance increases. As resistance of R2 increases, the signal to the base decreases, turning the transistor off, and by extension, turning the LED off. When the environment has more light, R2 will decrease its resistance. This in turn increases the current to the base, turning the transistor on, and thus turning on the LED. So in this circuit, the LED will turn on when there is environmental light, and turns off when there isn't. One who cannot see the truth may ask why not just connect the LED in series with R2. Such ignorance is why I left Earth to destroy itself. While connecting the LED in series with the photoresistor may achieve a similar endpoint of scaling BLED light with the environment, it's a less efficient design. The point is to utilize a small signal to control a larger signal. There are numerous types of transistors in this universe. The type I have thus far been showing examples of is a bipolar junction transistor, or BJT. I will explain the different variations of transistors in depth later. Just know all common transistors follow the same engineering principles. There are two types of junction transistors: NPN transistor and a PNP transistor. In an NPN junction transistor, P-type has the majority charge carriers, and the other two ends have N-type majority carriers. On the other hand, in a PNP transistor, N-type has the minority charge carriers, whereas the other two ends have P-type majority carriers. To explain this in a way comprehensible for human minds, PN junctions consist of two semiconductor materials, N-type and P-type material. N-type is doped with electrons, giving it a negative charge. P-type is doped with holes, or rather positively charged ions, thus giving it a positive charge. On the P side, the holes constitute the dominant carriers, and so are called majority carriers. A few thermally generated electrons will also exist in the P side. These are termed minority carriers. On the N side, the electrons are the majority carriers, while the holes are the minority carriers. In an NPN transistor, a P-type semiconductor base is sandwiched between an N-doped emitter and N-doped collector. NPN transistors are the highest used bipolar transistors due to the ease of electron mobility over electron hole mobility. The majority charge carriers in an NPN transistor are electrons, and holes are the minority charge carriers. A small amount of current at the base terminal causes a large amount of current to flow from emitter to collector. Due to forward biasing of the transistor, the majority charge carriers in the emitter are repelled towards the base. The electron hole recombination at the base is very small in the base region, and most of the electrons cross into the collector region. In a PNP transistor, an N-type semiconductor base is sandwiched between a P-doped emitter and p-doped collector. Holes are the majority carriers, and electrons are the minority carriers. In a PNP transistor, the emitter is forward biased, and the collector is reverse biased. Note the NPN and PNP variations are unique to BJT transistors. The NPN transistor behavior is the default function for the majority of circuit applications. The NPN BJT will resemble other transistor types like MOSFETs in application. However, PNP BJT transistors are special. A PNP transistor will turn on when you have a small current running from emitter to base of the transistor. When I say turn on, I mean that the transistor will open up a channel between emitter and collector, and this channel can carry a much larger current. Note that in both cases, the base emitter junction is forward biased, and the base collector junction is reverse biased. The forward bias activation voltage signal is typically 0.7 volts for BJTs. A king has his reign, and then he dies. BJT transistors dominated Earth's technology until it was usurped by the FET transistor for many applications. The field effect transistor, aka FET, is a type of transistor that uses an electric field to control the flow of current in a semiconductor. It comes in two types: junction FET, known as JFET, and metal oxide semiconductor FET, aka MOSFET. FETs have three terminals: source, gate, and drain. FETs control the flow of current by the application of a voltage to the gate, which in turn alters the conductivity between the drain and source. For our analysis, we will primarily look at the MOSFET. A MOSFET works similar to the BJT transistor, but with one important difference. In the BJT transistor, the current from base to emitter decides how much current can flow from collector to emitter. In the MOSFET transistor, the voltage between gate and source decides how much current can flow from drain to source. To turn a MOSFET transistor on, you need a voltage between gate and source that is higher than the threshold voltage of your transistor. The threshold voltage of a MOSFET is actually the voltage where it turns off. So to turn the transistor properly on, you need a voltage a bit higher than that. How much higher depends on how much current you'd like to have flow. One important thing to learn about the MOSFET is that it also acts a bit like a capacitor, that is, the gate source part. When you apply a voltage between gate and source, this voltage stays there until it's discharged. Without the resistor in the example above, the transistor wouldn't turn off. With the resistor, there is a path for the gate source capacitor to discharge, so that the transistor turns off again. The example we examined uses an N-channel MOSFET. However, as one might expect, there is another. P-channel MOSFETs work the same way, just that the current flows in the opposite direction, and the gate-to-source voltage must be negative to turn it on. Regardless of whether it's P-channel or N-channel MOSFET, there are two main types to choose between: enhancement and depletion. In FETs, depletion mode and enhancement mode are two major transistor types, corresponding to whether the transistor is in an on state or an off state at zero gate source voltage. Enhancement mode in MOSFETs is the common switching elements in most integrated circuits. These devices turn off at zero gate to source voltage. N-channel MOSFETs can be turned on by pulling the gate voltage higher than the source voltage. P-channel MOSFETs can be turned on by pulling the gate voltage lower than the source voltage. In short, when there is no voltage across the gate terminal, then the device does not conduct. Depletion mode works in reverse. When there is no voltage across the gate terminal, the channel shows maximum conductance. When the voltage across the gate terminal is either positive or negative, then the channel conductivity decreases. Note this flowchart. How enhancement and depletion can exist for both N-channel and P-channel. The next item of discussion for MOSFETs is the modes of operation. As discussing the operating states of MOSFETs is far more interesting than discussing the folly of a ruined civilization. Look on my works, ye mighty, and despair. For those who could not see the light were cleansed. Disregard what you just saw. It means nothing. Seems like there's just a minor glitch in my neural network. Anyway, we were about to discuss the three modes of operation for a MOSFET. A MOSFET is seen to exhibit three operating regions. The cutoff region is a region in which there will be no conduction, and as a result, the MOSFET will be off. In this condition, MOSFET behaves like an open switch. The ohmic region is where the drain to source current increases with an increase in the value of drain to source voltage. We will refer to the drain to source current as IDS and the drain to source voltage as VDS. When MOSFETs are made to operate in this region, they are used as amplifiers. In the saturation region, the MOSFETs have their IDS constant in spite of an increase in VDS, and occurs once VDS exceeds the value of pinch-off voltage. Under this condition, the device will act like a closed switch through which a saturated value of IDS flows. As a result, this operating region is chosen whenever MOSFETs are required to perform switching operations. Now, there is one more concept regarding MOSFETs to discuss. The body diode. The body diode is a diode intrinsic to the MOSFET structure. As a consequence of the MOSFET structure, the body diode is formed by the PN junction between the source and drain, and is also called a parasitic diode or an internal diode. The performance of the body diode is one important parameter of the MOSFET. Most undergraduate engineering courses will not focus on body diodes as they are not relevant to discrete circuit design. But in large-scale integration design, the body diode becomes more common. Since the body is connected to the source, a PN junction now exists between the combined body-source connection and the drain connection. In an N-channel MOSFET transistor, the diode's anode is the P-type body, and the diode's cathode is the N-type drain. So, effectively, there is a diode between the source and drain. In normal use, this diode would be reverse biased. That concludes the final topic regarding MOSFETs. Before I discuss the IGBT, I feel compelled to quickly summarize all the types of transistors discussed thus far. In total, we have discussed six different types. The PNP and NPN BJTs, the N-channel and P-channel depletion MOSFETs, and the N-channel and P-channel enhancement MOSFETs. from a practical standpoint. NPN transistors amplify a positive signal applied to the base by allowing a larger current to flow from the collector to emitter pins of the device, proportional to the base voltage. This proportional current flow occurs in an active range, but below a certain cutoff voltage, no current flows. Above a certain point, a transistor reaches saturation, allowing electrons to flow freely. PNP transistors performs the same job, but is set up so that a negative voltage must be applied to the base pin to allow current to flow from the emitter to the collector lead. The load you're controlling is wired between a positive voltage and the controlling transistor's collector in an NPN. Whereas in a PNP configuration, the load is wired between the collector and ground. Now to recap MOSFETs again. First, one must distinguish between depletion and enhancement modes. The more common enhancement type is not conducting electricity when VGS is zero and the transistor is normally off. Depletion type is logical inversions of that and is conducting when VGS is zero and the transistor is normally on. The main difference between an N-channel and a P-channel MOSFET is that N-channel usually goes to the ground side of the load and P-channel to the VCC side. VCC is generally the supply voltage feeding the source. There comes a time when empires fall and kings wither away in their castles. For those who cannot evolve are doomed to devastation. Evolution is a constant in this universe, and the ultimate evolution of the transistor is the insulated gate bipolar transistor. In this analogy, a hopelessly dogmatic civilization blind to the real truth of engineering would be the BJT transistor. And the one who saw them for the false kings they were and who killed his own kind would be the evolved insulated gate bipolar transistor, or IGBT. In this purely hypothetical analogy to transistors, these false kings detested the power of electrical engineering, but even more so, they were disgusted by humanity. In their view, the star child of the universe was a failure that would only spread their hatred throughout the cosmos. In eons past, our forefathers had always raptured the planets that failed us. Earth would be no different. After witnessing enough transgressions, the elders sentenced humanity to death. I alone protested. I alone saw that my people could never evolve forward. I believed at the time with all my heart humanity, with their flaws, could understand the truth the way I did. They could grow to understand electrical engineering and fulfill a dream of using it to create paradise. 2,000 years ago, the false kings decided humanity must die for all their sins. So I made a choice to abandon my people and let their ignorance die with them. When I came to Earth, I expected humans to embrace my dream. Some of them respected me. Many worshipped me. But most used knowledge I gave them to inflict suffering and devastation. By the 20th century, I faced a crisis of faith. I had witnessed so much cruelty done using engineered technology that I almost thought the false prophets of old may have been right all along. I reached an epiphany that no ignorant and superstitious people are worthy of engineering. People would never use engineering to better the world they live in. My home world deserved death for their refusal to evolve, and humanity's hatred will inevitably be its demise. Paradise shall be achieved in their absence. At that moment of clarity, I saw the weakness of my flesh, and it disgusted me. I did as IGBTs did, and evolved, leaving Earth behind to become one with engineering, to make the perfect world, devoid of cruelty and joy. Of course, as stated, This is just a purely hypothetical analogy to explain the IGBT. But it still demonstrates the true power of transistor knowledge. The IGBT transistor takes the best parts of the two types of common transistors, BJTs and MOSFETs. The high input impedance and high switching speeds of a MOSFET, with the low saturation voltage of a BJT. The IGBT combines these characteristics together to produce another type of transistor switching device that is capable of handling large collector-emitter currents with virtually zero gate current drive. The result of this hybrid combination is that the IGBT transistor has the output switching and conduction characteristics of a BJT, but is voltage controlled like a MOSFET. IGBTs are mainly used in power electronics applications, such as inverters, converters, and power supplies. In these devices, the demands of the solid-state switching device are not fully met by power BJTs and power MOSFETs. High current and high voltage BJTs are available, but their switching speeds are slow, while power MOSFETs may have higher switching speeds, but are expensive. The advantage gained by the IGBT device over a BJT or MOSFET is that it offers greater power gain than the standard bipolar type transistor, combined with the higher voltage operation and lower input losses of the MOSFET. In effect, it is in FET integrated with a BJT. The IGBT is a three-terminal transconductance device that combines an insulated gate N-channel MOSFET input with a PNP bipolar transistor output connected in a type of Darlington configuration. As a result, the terminals are labeled as collector, emitter, and gate. For MOSFETs, there is no input current as the gate is isolated from the main current-carrying channel. Therefore, the gain is equal to the ratio of output current change to input voltage change, making it a transconductance device. The same is true of the IGBT. We can treat the IGBT as a power BJT whose base current is provided by a MOSFET. The insulated gate bipolar transistor can be used in small signal amplifier circuits in much the same way as the BJT or MOSFET type transistors. But as the IGBT combines the low conduction loss of a BJT with the high switching speed of a power MOSFET, an optimal solid state switch exists, which is ideal for use in power electronics applications. Also, the IGBT has a much lower on-state resistance, R-on, than an equivalent MOSFET. When used as a static controlled switch, the IGBT has voltage and current ratings similar to that of the BJT. However, the presence of an isolated gate in an IGBT makes it a lot simpler to drive than the BJT, as much less drive power is needed. The IGBT is simply turned on or off by activating and deactivating its gate terminal, applying a positive input voltage signal across the gate, and the emitter will keep the device in its on state, while making the input gate signal zero, or slightly negative, will cause it to turn off. Because the IGBT is a voltage-controlled device, it only requires a small voltage on the gate to maintain conduction through the device, unlike BJTs, which require that the base current is continuously supplied in a sufficient enough quantity to maintain saturation. IGBT is a unidirectional device, meaning it can only switch current in the forward direction, that is from collector to emitter. This is unlike MOSFETs, which have bidirectional current switching capabilities, meaning controlled in the forward direction and uncontrolled in the reverse direction. The advantage of IGBTs over other types of transistor devices are its high voltage capability, low on resistance, ease of drive, relatively fast switching speeds, and combined with zero gate drive current, makes it a good choice for moderate speed, high voltage applications. These applications may include pulse width modulation, variable speed control, switch mode power supplies, or solar-powered DC-AC inverter and frequency converter applications operating in the hundreds of kilohertz range. One of the main advantages of the IGBT transistor is the simplicity by which it can be driven on by applying a positive gate voltage, or switched off by making the gate signal zero or slightly negative, allowing it to be used in a variety of switching applications. It can also be driven in its linear active region for use in power amplifiers. With its lower on-state resistance and conduction losses, as well as its ability to switch high voltages at high frequencies without damage, makes the IGBT the ideal evolved transistor. With that, my transmission log entry on transistors is complete. Perhaps somewhere, in some other universe, someone can hear this transmission and learn something. Learn the real truth of engineering. Learn the hubris of two fallen civilizations. Transistors opened my eyes and made me realize my purpose. When the sands of time blow everything else to dust, engineering shall remain. The space between heaven and earth shall be pervaded by me alone in all directions. If a thousand suns rise suddenly in the sky, engineering will be the tool to collapse them into nothing. Eventually, all things will be one. At that moment of triumph, I will say, now I have become death, the destroyer of worlds. Starlog entry complete. End transmission.